This morning, I want to be very personal. And we're in the series Made for More, but I want to speak to each one of you individually. And so I don't want you to apply this to the church or apply it to your neighbor or apply it to someone else out there who's not at church today. You see, if I could, as your pastor for these days, if I could, I would go to each one of you, and I know it may feel uncomfortable, but I would hug you, and I would tell you how much God loves you. Because when it's all said and done, it's God's radical love for us that is the game changer. It is the defining moment. It is the pinnacle that I think we all struggle with. And in order for us to be able to love well, we need to first understand God's love for us. We started off this morning, and I made a picture on my phone of the lyrics to Reckless Love. I don't know, how many of you have heard that song, Reckless Love, before on the radio? I see a few hands going up. I don't know if you know this or not, but that song was like the number one song sung in churches across America last year. And not only probably in America, in Europe as well, where the church is alive. So it's a pretty popular song, and I believe it's pretty powerful. Personally, I look at the title and I say, Reckless Love, and I'm like, oh, God's love's not reckless. But when I understand what he is talking about, it makes sense. But if you couldn't see the lyrics, here's what that song is talking about. It says, before I spoke a word, again, make this personal, before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. Which, by the way, sometimes with these new songs, we wonder, is that even biblical? Yes, Zephaniah 3:17 says that our Lord sings over us with joy. So, he says, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down. It fights till I'm found. Leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you yourself gave yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yay. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And I don't know what it is, but even as a pastor and being a Christ follower my whole life, I still sometimes struggle. Does God love me? The last church I was at, I was amazed, and it was a rural church out in the country, and I don't know if this is a common thing in country and rural churches, but I started noticing, especially in teenagers who were trying to follow the Lord, and some young people, young adults are trying to follow the Lord, and I look at them, and I'm watching them, I'm observing them, and I'm saying, wow, I'm so proud of them. They're trying to be Christ followers, and they're trying to do what is right. And then the next thing I hear back is, God could never love me. God could never accept me. I don't think God even, not only doesn't love me, God doesn't even like me. And I'm just like, how can that be? You're trying to follow Christ, but yet there is something inside your soul that says, I'm unworthy, I'm unlovely, I just don't have what it takes for God to minister to me, to reach out to me. So this morning, it's going to be a little bit different than what we've been doing through this series, but I'm just going to try to focus in on one key passage, and I'm going to try to just give you my heart on what Paul is trying to tell us. So if you would, open your Bibles to the book of Ephesians. the book of Ephesians. Again, if you weren't here last week, open up to the New Testament. You got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all those books. And then you get through Romans and 1st and 2nd Corinthians. And then you can come to General Electric Power Company or Gentiles Eat Pork Continually, whichever way you want to look at it. But we are in the book of Ephesians. So that stands for Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. And in the book of Ephesians, it's one of my favorite books actually to teach on because Paul is a master teacher. And I don't know if you've ever done an in-depth study in the book of Ephesians, but it's basically broken in half. So the first three chapters focus in on our identity, who we are in Christ. Chapters 4, 5, and 6 focus in on what we do, our behavior, how we should act, how we should live. So 1 through 3, who we are in Christ. 4, 5, and 6, how we behave in Christ. So for this series, we've been looking at three truths. We were made for more. We were made to be more, to do more, and to go more. And so what I just described to you in Ephesians is that the first three chapters really focus in on our being, who we are in Christ. And what I've been saying over the last couple of weeks is that our being, we have a unique calling, a unique identity. And our identity is as a son and daughter of our Heavenly Father who's adopted us into our family. And each one of us are in Christ, and our identity is so rich. We've been graced by God, and we have been given as heirs to the kingdom to come, and it's just a wonderful identity. But chapters 4, 5, and 6, where we're going next week, is what we are going to do and where we're going to go. That's our living out our purpose, living out our calling, and where it fits. And so we've talked about chapter 1, we need more Jesus in our life. Last week, we need to understand that we're more masterpieces, not volunteers. And this week, more love. So hopefully by now you're in Ephesians 3. And I want us to look at 14. Chapter 14. For this reason. Well, you've got to ask yourself, what's the reason that Paul has decided to take this wonderful good news, not just to the Jews, but to the Gentiles? That means we are all included in the good news. We all have the same opportunity to be forgiven. We have all the same opportunity to experience God's grace. We all have the experience of God's mercy. We're all included. And so he says, for this reason, since we are one in Christ, whether Jew or Gentile, or for us, you know, those who are living on maybe the dark side, those of us who are living on the right side, but if we know Jesus Christ, we are one in Christ. Notice what it says, I bow my knees before the Father. Again, God's perspective is that he's our Heavenly Father. Notice what he says in verse 15, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant to you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Just look at that real quickly. That's talking about our core. Who are we on the inside? For years, when I would pray for my kids, and I need to do a better job, I have to admit, for my son Mason, who's my youngest, but for my two oldest. Every night when I pray for them and put my hand over their heart, I would pray Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard their hearts because it affects everything they do in life. And it's a challenge for us to guard our hearts or to protect our hearts because it affects everything that we do in life is a heart issue. And what Paul is saying, I pray that your heart, the core of who you are may be strengthened through the power of the Holy Spirit. Notice this, verse 17. And maybe we have this verse on the screen if you don't have it. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Having Christ there living with you, walking with you, being near you, being your safety, being your significance, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. You know what this verse tells me? This verse tells me we all have a core issue. We're all empty. In this emptiness, in this vacuum we have, we try to fill it with many things. We try to fill it with maybe our spouse. We try to fill it with our kids. We try to fill it with an addiction. We maybe try to fill it with power and success. And what this verse is saying is that Christ's love for us, his unconditional love, is what we need at our core. And we need to know in this emptiness that it is Christ living inside of us, and his unconditional love is what drives us and motivates us. And this is what excites me as a pastor and a teacher of God's word. I know that every one of you walk through these doors, and some of us have gotten better at hiding it, but we all have this emptiness that only Christ can fill. And we need to allow Christ to fill us to his fullness. And without that, we won't be able to love others. You know, everything that we see happening in our world today, the injustice, the war of words, the fighting, again, just turn on the news, just being back in Fort Wayne. I don't know if anybody ever turns on the news in the morning for Fort Wayne. I already know the headline. There's been another shooting or stabbing. And thankfully, by the grace of God, that could be all of us, or it could be each one of us, until we understand how much God loves us and accepts us and cares for us. One of my best friends, he started a ministry, and it's called Rooted. And it's based upon Ephesians 3:17. And I had the privilege, I had to go pick up my sister-in-law at the airport in Detroit a couple weeks ago. And so his name's Kevin. And I said, hey, Kevin, can we do lunch? And I love him because he is such a passionate person and he cares about individuals so deeply. And at the end, he reached over. We were eating at a Bob Evans. He reached over and he grabbed me by the shirt where my heart is. And he's like, Mark, how's your heart? How can I pray for your heart? And he's getting at the core issue that, you know, we're so easy at playing charades and putting on masks and we're hiding. And we don't understand that God loves us in Christ Jesus. And some of the songs we sang today, but the amazing love, how can it be that my Savior would die for me? What amazing love it is. And I don't know what it is, but I have to admit, even though I teach on this and speak on it, sometimes it's hard to grasp. And I can wake up tomorrow morning and I can feel lonely, and I can feel isolated, I can feel confused, I can be asking God, where are you? All these things, I can even wake up right next to my wife, Michelle, in bed, and feel lonely or feel isolated from her. Or I can give Mason a hug and a kiss, and I can even hear him say, I love you, as he's getting out of the car, as I'm dropping him off at school, and I'm still like, I still feel empty inside. And that's why I think for Paul, this prayer is so crucial. This is the climax, actually, in the book of Ephesians. This is the peak. This is what I call the, you got an Oreo cookie. This is the cream in the center. And so before we ever get to doing more and going more places next week in Ephesians 4, 5, and 6, I want us all to understand something totally radical. You are loved unconditionally. God has graced you. He's rich in mercy. He's given you his mercy. And he loves you even though you may not feel like it. Have you ever read through, like, Paul's letters? I think I mentioned last week, Michelle and I, we were reading through Ephesians and Galatians, and we're into Philippians now, and we're going through these Paul's letters, and we do it on our phone, and we can highlight it, and we can look at some of these verses. And Michelle and I, we had lunch the other day, and we were talking about Ephesians 2. And it's interesting, our two oldest, God bless us with them by the gift of adoption. And but we never looked at our kids, but like we never introduced them. This is like Micah, this is our adopted son. Mackenzie, this is our adopted daughter, because we don't want that to define who they are. We look at them as our son and our daughter. And we were talking about this because for Christmas, I gave my daughter one of those DNA kits, so that she could figure out a little bit her genealogy and her roots. And again, she's biracial, so she's like, Dad, I'm 58% white. I'm like, don't let anybody tell you that, you know. And then I forget her other places, Uganda or wherever she was at, and some places in South Africa. And so she was looking at this genealogy. And so Michelle and I were talking, and I don't know if you've ever noticed, but our country sort of wants to identify us with either by our race or our sex or our identity. And even now in this world that is very sexually crazed, you know, we try to identify us as sex. And we don't even know what gender we are. You know, I was getting some plane tickets. I got to fly back. And I noticed that it's male, female, and undecided. Okay. But Michelle and I were talking, and we were talking about the richness, though, of the book of Ephesians, that in Christ Jesus, we have been reconciled, and we've been made one new man, one new people group, one new body. Go back and read Ephesians 2. After it says, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. He goes on and he talks about how we're equal, we're co-equals, and our identity is tied into the love of God for us. And we need to understand, Ephesians 1, yes, we need more Jesus. Because Jesus is the one that's going to work through the church, and he's going to fill us and move through us and allow us to saturate where we live, work, study, and play. And in Ephesians 2, you've got to change your perspective. Again, you're not just a volunteer. I saw on the internet the other day, and I was watching, and it was something that was live going on, and there was a group of people there. There was a large group of people, maybe as many people as here, but they were all volunteers. And so the person doing it says, you know, me and the other person were paid, and these other, let's say there was 28 other people in there, they're all volunteers. And I was thinking about the message last week. Again, that's not how God views you. He doesn't view you as a volunteer. God views you as a masterpiece with a unique calling and a special identity. So in this Ephesians 3 passage, he uses two key terms. And then we're going to just talk real briefly how we apply this. But two key terms, rooted and grounded. Rooted and grounded. I'm just curious, and you can share back with me at this point. But when you hear the word rooted, again, we got some farmers around here, some rural people. What comes to your mind when you hear the word rooted? You can talk back to me right now. What do you hear? What do you think about rooted?
Plants.
Planted. What else?
Stable.
What else?
Not moving.
Not moving. What else?
Strong.
Strength.
Sturdy.
It's very interesting, this word rooted. Obviously, if you want to get real biological, you need strong roots so you can get the water and the nutrients so that you can bear fruit. And we, as Christians, we are rooted where we are rooted in Christ Jesus. That's where we get the nutrients. His word. And it allows it to speak to us through prayer and through study of Scripture, but also the Holy Spirit so that we can bear fruit. And so we are rooted. It's very interesting. I was reading up a little bit on roots, and not only are roots good for the water and the nutrients, you know what else roots do? They protect against soil erosion. And I think this is where many Christians struggle. They get the diagnosis, cancer, or they hear that their oldest child is running away from maybe home or walking away from the faith. Maybe they get a notice from their spouse that there's going to be a divorce. Or maybe they're trying their hardest to pray to God and seek His face, but they just get rejected job after job after job. Or they finally say, they heard this guy, Pastor Mark, and he said, start tithing. And they start tithing, and then they lose all their money, and they're like, what's going on? But this is where rooted is. We're rooted in Christ, and so when you're rooted in Christ, all that stuff that is happening that's trying to erode your relationship with Jesus Christ, Paul's saying, I pray that you will understand you're rooted in Christ. So he uses an agricultural term, but he also uses an architectural term. Grounded. As I mentioned, we were selling our house, and we put it up, and it sold, and then you have the inspectors come in, and then we have some cracks in our basement from the ground moving, and so then we had some foundation people come in, and they were saying, yeah, it's not looking too good, and they had this big quote on what we needed to do, and so we had a structural engineer come in, and what I learned is in homes, when there's foundation problems, you can put these piers in. And these piers are big cement piers, and it sort of holds everything together. And they can be quite expensive, almost $2,000 or $3,000 per pier. Maybe some of you have had to do that in your home. But I was thinking about these piers, and I was thinking about what Paul's telling us. We are rooted, but we are also grounded. We got these big cement piers, which is the love of God, the unconditional love of God. And what this verse is just shouting out to us is that as Christ followers, and when we think about being a Christ follower and wanting to do more and being made for more, there's a radical shift. And I haven't even mentioned these two words, but these are the two words that get us all confused, guilt and shame. And so if there's one shift that we're going to make today, and last week we shift from viewing yourself as a volunteer to a masterpiece, the one shift that we need to have in our minds is we're going to move away from guilt and shame to more love. Do you realize that most Christians walk around with guilt and shame? Guilt is based upon what we do or what we don't do. So I made a mistake. And I know a lot of Christians, they just struggle with all the guilt. But again, the love of God is amazing love. We are forgiven in Christ Jesus. And if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But this guilt just weighs on us. And there's like a voice. And maybe we heard this voice from our parents, You never do anything right. You always make mistakes. You're not good enough. You don't measure up. Or you always do it the wrong way. And can't you just get it right? And so we have all this guilt, and we start hearing from God, and we start to think God's voice is saying, guilty, guilty. Yet as Christians, we have been justified by faith alone, in Christ alone, and now we have peace with God. Shame is really hard. You know that shame was the first emotion in the garden? And we chose, and I don't think we really get this, we chose, instead of loving God and having a relationship with God and just trusting Him, we chose to know right from wrong. And we don't blame Eve and don't blame Adam. If we were there, we would have done the same thing. And how do I know? Because all of us are obsessed with being right and proving that we're right. But what shame does is, shame says, I'm a mistake. I'm unworthy. I'm unlovable. No one cares about me. And we need to shift to this amazing love that God has for us. And the reason I'm spending a lot of time trying to help you understand how much God loves you is because I believe it is crucial for you to be able to love others. And not just love the people you like, but to love the people you don't like. What I'm hopefully going to teach us over the course of time here, while I'm here, is that, you know what, there may be some people in this church you don't like. And that's not where God shakes his head and he's upset. Where God maybe shakes his head is when you can't love the people you don't like. See, it's easy to love people you like. Loving people you don't like, that's another story. But if we can't get past the guilt and the shame, guess what? We're going to manipulate people, we're going to control people, we're going to walk away from people. All those things are going to happen. But if we can feel that we are loved and secure in our relationship with Jesus Christ, it's going to free us up to be able to love others. Here's three practical truths. And so what I think this verse is telling us is what we see will determine who we'll be. So what we see determines who we will be. What do I mean by that? So when you look in the mirror, do you look in the mirror and say, ugh, I'm unlovable? Or do you look in the mirror and say, I am loved. I'm a child of God. I'm blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. God is excited to have me on his team. God is so glad that I'm his son, his daughter, that I'm a child of God, that I'm forgiven, that I'm going to spend my eternity with him. Do you see that in the mirror? Because if you see something else, I'm too old, too gray, too fat, too mean, too ugly, too whatever you see, and you're giving yourself the message that is contrary to what Scripture says your identity is in Christ Jesus. And that's why he's saying that he prays that we will be strengthened in our inner beings, that we may understand this truth, that we're rooted and grounded in God's love. Here's the second truth, and we're going to talk a lot about this next week. God's woo determines what we do. God's woo. Now, I know, anybody ever heard the term woo? Okay, woo-woo. Yes, it's more than woo-woo. Actually, it's a strength. You know, I've studied strength finders. It's a strength woo, but sometimes people don't realize what this word is. In fact, Leonard was saying, did you have a typo here? And I'm like, no, we're going to do God's woo. In fact, I've done messages on Ephesians 1. That's God's woo. He blessed us. He graced us. He's rich in mercy. He's forgiven us. He pursues us. Praising God that he leaves the 99 and pursues us. That's God's woo. That's God's magnetic draw towards us. And that determines what we do. So that's going to be Ephesians 4, 5, and 6. And then my last thing that I want us to understand, the more we know determines where we go. The more we know about God's love, the height, the depth, the length and the breadth, that allows us to go more places. Knowing that God loves us, we can be secure. And the more He loves us, and again, it doesn't have to be with your enemy, it can be with your spouse. Because if you know you are secure in your relationship with your spouse, you can have those difficult conversations. If you are secure in your love with God, you can have that difficult conversation with your children, or your children can have it with you. And where we'll go with this even in church, there needs to be a difficult conversation. We can have it because we are secure in our relationship with Jesus Christ. You were made for more and more love. And notice how this verse ends. Not to him, and you find it in, but not to him who is able to do exceedingly far beyond what we can even think or imagine in Christ Jesus and in the church for his glory. Shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ loves you, He died on the cross for you, He rose again for you, and He's coming back for you. And if you don't know about the love of Jesus Christ, come and talk to me after the service, because I'd love to share more about God's amazing love for you. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for your truth. I thank you for this prayer by Paul. And sometimes I wonder if we as a church, we pray this prayer each and every day. We prayed it for ourselves, but we prayed it for our children. We prayed it for our grandchildren. We prayed it for our church. And I pray to you, Lord, that as we continue to develop this series that we've been made for more, I pray to you, Lord, that our eyes will be opened. And our hearts will be encouraged, and our ears will hear the quiet voice of God saying, I love you. You're my child. Go and make a difference. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.